was in 1976. Not that long ago for some of us, and ancient history for many others. A Christian philosopher named Francis Schaeffer published a book called How Shall We Then Live? The Rise and Decline of Western Thought and Culture, 1976. In the book and in the accompanying video series that was produced, Dr. Schaeffer stated, "There is a flow to history and culture. This flow is rooted in how people think, and how people think will determine how they act." Now, Dr. Schaeffer was trained as a philosopher and a theologian, but he would have made a very good cognitive behavioral therapist with what he said. How we think determines how we act. Now, we've been working our way through the book of Ephesians, and Paul has been laying out for the church in Ephesus, for the church of all time, and for us, profoundly rich doctrine that ought to be shaping how we think and what we believe. And so, in light of what Paul has written, what are we thinking? And what are we doing? So we've reached the halfway point in Paul's letter, at least by the chapter designations. But that's not the significant part. The significant part is that at this point in the letter, beginning with chapter 4, Paul makes a pivot, like a door turning on a hinge. Basically, it's because of what I've written to you, because of what God has done, because of this truth, now you fill in the blank. Now you go, you do, you work, you obey, you live a changed life. The foundation of any kind of transformative power lies in the truth of the first three chapters. And we do have to keep it in proper order. You know, some people, they want the goodness that flows from Christianity, but they don't want Christianity. Richard Dawkins, earlier this year, lamented the demise of organized Christianity in England because he saw the impact that the demise of Christianity was having on the culture in England. We can't have an impact if it's not based in the truth. And so we must not forget what Paul has told us in the first three chapters. He establishes the theological foundation of what God has done in Christ in saving us, his people, and in bringing us into fellowship with him and with each other. Now in chapters 4 through 6, Paul will lay out the practical application of what our faith means. Because of what God has done in delivering us from the domain of darkness and transferring us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, as he states in Colossians 1, we are now to walk in newness of life, as he wrote to the Romans. So some have said that a basic outline for the book of Ephesians is that chapters 1 through 3, that's the church's belief statement, and chapters 4 through 6, that's the church's mission statement. Alistair Begg, in his series on Ephesians, says that in chapters 1 through 3, Paul is emphasizing the indicative. Leave it to someone from the British Isles to use such fancy terminology. Paul is emphasizing the indicative, what is. And now in chapters 4 through 6, he's emphasizing the imperative. In his commentary on Ephesians, William Klein wrote, "It is one thing to designate the believer standing in Christ. It is another thing for believers to live out this status in the life of the church. Paul believes that the omission of the latter invalidates the truth of the former. Given the essence of the church, Paul urges his readers to pursue unity. He reminds them that all the members of this organism, the church, are variously gifted to build it up to maturity as all of them together play their part. Unity based on truth and love is the key to fulfilling their calling as believers." Now, I'm going to be going over the same passage that Pastor preached last week. And I don't know if you noticed at all, but there wasn't a title for today's message. Now, I was given a title recommendation by someone who's very close to Dan Meyer. And he said, since Pastor preached last week on the same passage, the title of my passage should be, "You Have Heard It Said, But I Say." I'm not quite ready for that. But I thought about some other titles. Live As You Now Are. Live As You Now Are. But I thought, given the current trend in society with how I now identify myself, I'm not sure I want to encourage everyone to just go ahead and claim that as their right. So this is what I came up with. I suppose I should have it in front of me so I get it right. The church. Unity in diversity, moving toward maturity under the Trinity. Let's pray. Amen. The church, unity and diversity, moving toward maturity under the Trinity. Let me highlight three passages from the first three chapters, just to help us get oriented to today's message. The first, Ephesians 1, 3 through 4. Remember, Paul started this letter with this great hymn of praise. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him." And then in love moves into verse 5, but we'll end it right there. "That we should be holy and blameless before him." We're called for a purpose. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. Well, I'll read 8 through 10. Sorry, Kaylee. "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them." And then finally, Ephesians 3, 20 and 21. Pastor just cited that in praying for the upcoming week. "Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever." It's according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church. Does that drive your thinking? That the church is to glorify God. And Paul tells us now in chapters 4 through 6, this is how it's supposed to be done. So now, chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower regions, the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. Whew, I think I need to sit down. Paul lays out a lot for us in this passage. So I toyed around with three titles, but I only have 2 points to my sermon. Point number one, walk worthy of his call. Now notice what he says. He says, I therefore, and of course, the therefore always refers to what has come before. A prisoner of the Lord, chapter 3, verse 1, he also mentions being a prisoner for the Lord. Now if it was me writing it, it might say something like that. I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to hire the best attorney you can to get me out of the fix I'm in. Paul doesn't say that. He says, I urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called. To walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called. He doesn't say, you were so worthy, therefore you were called. Because not one of us is worthy to be called. But he says, you were called, now walk worthy of that calling. Worthy has a meaning kind of weightiness. So if we had scales, God's call on our life is a heavy thing, and the scale kind of goes like this. But to walk worthy of that call weighs down the other side and brings it balance. Our walk is to be in balance with what God has called us to. Walk worthy of the Lord. And I just also want to say this. When Paul uses the word, I urge you, or some versions might say, beseech you, he could very well be saying, I beg you. Don't miss this. You have been called to fellowship with God. Now, live up to that. Conduct yourself accordingly. Our actions must match our words. He goes on then in verse 2. With all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now, in prepping for this morning, I found out that part of the backdrop to Greek culture, they really despised the idea of humility. Humility, to be lowly, was to be servile, was to cower, as if a dog cowering before his master because he misbehaved. Okay, that's not how men are supposed to live their lives, according to the Greeks. And Paul says, be humble. In all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love. These are the attributes that Christ put on display. So if we want to know how we're going to be, let's look to Christ. There is no place for arrogance. There is no place for haughtiness. There's no place for self-will. There's no place for drawing attention to oneself in the church. We have been saved by grace. Remember what he tells us in chapter 2. We were by nature children of wrath. We were dead in our trespasses and sins. We had nothing of our own accord to stand on. But it's by God's great love, his mercy made us alive. That's the only reason why we stand. So if we're going to boast, we boast in the Lord. We don't draw attention to ourselves. And we're going to bear with one another, you know, with patience, bear with one another in love. I can testify that there's someone here this morning, and on Thursday we'll be celebrating 37 years. She's been profoundly patient, and she's exercised what it means to bear with one another in love. Thank you, Cindy. I need to clarify something right now. I do not get emotional or cry. I just come down with colds that fast. And there's Cindy going, man, why do I even take him out in public? You know? If you've lived with anyone for any length of time, and we as a community, we know we have to be patient with one another. We have to bear with one another. The New Testament is filled with all kinds of one anothering. That is what needs to be exercised in the church. And he goes on to say, eager to maintain the purity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now, who doesn't love peace? Peace. Ah, peace, and usually quiet comes with it. But peace is the bond that holds us together. Peace is the fastener that connects us. Peace is not the absence of war. If you've lived long enough, you will know what a Cold War is like. It's not peaceful. It may not mean that there's no shooting, but it's not peaceful. I mean, for 50 years almost after World War II, we experienced, if you were alive during that time, the Cold War. The U.S. and the Soviet Union facing each other down. I have more nukes than you do. My nukes are better than yours. We lived in a world that was mad. Mutually assured destruction. How's that for peace? That's not to be in the church. And I just need to say that if there's conflict between any two or three or 10 of you, you need to work to maintain that bond of peace. He says, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit. This takes work on our part. We just don't pretend it away. Now, I don't have a hard and fast rule for you. I just want to direct you to this. If there's conflict, and you know I'm in conflict with this other person, then go to that person and work through it. Now, I had people approach me some years ago because, quite frankly, I had offended them, and they came to me, and they were, and remain to this day, profoundly gracious to me. And that unity in the Spirit and that bond of peace is there because they followed God in obedience and came to me and said, we need to talk. So I want to encourage you to think hard and fast about that. This is hard work. We have been made one man, Paul says in chapter 2. The division between the Jew and Greek has been destroyed in Christ's body. We are united. Now work at that union. Maintain the bonds of peace. Okay? I mean, it's hard to imagine the cultural diversity that would have existed in the church at Ephesus or any of the first century churches, for that matter. But you had people coming out of rank paganism, coming to faith in Christ. You had people coming out of Judaism. You had slaves, and you had slave owners. You had people who had no standing in the culture, and you had people from the highest echelons of the culture. And Paul says, eagerly maintain the unity of peace, of the Spirit and the bond of peace. They had to work at it. We need to work at it. But we don't work at it in our own. We work on it, and we work at it because of who God is, what he's done in Christ, and by the power of the Holy Spirit. We need to submit to the work of God in that. And Paul goes on and says, here's what that unity looks like. Starting with verse 4. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope that belongs to your call. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. It feels like a creed, and commentators kind of debate back and forth, you know, was this a creed, was this a hymn, or was this Paul moved by the Holy Spirit? But whether it was a creed back then or not, this is a great creed for us to hold. We have union one with another in this one body because of one Spirit. We were called in one hope. We have one Lord. We have one faith. There is one baptism and one God and Father of all, over all, in all, through all. Do you think Paul is trying to tell us something? We're to be one because the Godhead is one. The Trinity is there. Spirit, Lord, Father. And in them, in that one Godhead, we now are one body, we have one hope, we're called to one faith. That faith is the truth of the gospel. That faith is what we believe, what we hold to. We don't make it up. We don't get to add to it or take away from it. There's one faith, and it's all summed up in one God and Father of all. So unity is key. He calls us to unity. Walk in a manner worthy of your calling and live out that unity to which he has called us. Point number two, so the first point, walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, verses 1-6. Point number two covers Ephesians now 7-16. Grow up. I was really looking forward to saying that, you know? Now I'll refer back to Cindy once more. She might say it more like this. Oh, grow up, you know, but it's the same message, right? But we're to grow up, and specifically, we're to grow up in Him. We're to grow in ministry. Verse 7. Now here we're going to begin to see some diversity. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gifts. So we're called to one faith. We're called to worship one God. We've been graced in salvation. But now there's a grace by which He's going to bestow gifts upon us. So we're united, but we're not uniform, except for next week when we all wear Hawaiian shirts, you know, but we're not all the same. You know, elsewhere in the New Testament, Paul says, you know, if we were all an eye, where would the hearing be, right? We need the diverse gifts that God bestows upon His church. We can't live without it. We need each other. To each one of us was given a gift according to the measure of Christ's gift. Each of you is gifted. If you're a Christian, you're gifted. As a friend of mine years ago said, he likes to stir up evangelicals by saying, oh, you're a Christian? You're charismatic. We've received the gifts of the Lord. Then he liked to say, oh, you're Catholic. Because as a Christian, we're part of one universal church. Okay? So let's emphasize the fact that while we're here together as one, we're not the same in the way that we are gifted, but it's according to the measure of Christ's gift. It's according to Christ's sovereignty. Now, this didn't happen in our house because we only had one son, but on Christmas morning, you can imagine if there's more than one child in the family. Mom, Dad, that's not fair. He got such and such, and I only got such and such. Maybe that never happened in your family. That happened in my family. It wasn't me. It was my sisters. Trust me. You know, kind of thing. There's no place for that in the church. It's Christ who gives gifts. And we ought to celebrate the gifts that He gives, not just to us individually, because it's like, wow, look at the gift I got. No, it's because now we have something to contribute, and we look around and we say, how great that that person has that gift to contribute, and that person has that gift to contribute. Remember, we're being knit into one being. If you've ever looked at yourself in the mirror, you know you have a variety of body parts. They're all needed. We're one body. All the parts are needed here. And they are given by Christ. And we're not to take issue with them, but we are to work in obedience to utilize them. The gifts, again, given to us individually, given to us to serve. All members of the church have been given a gift. And Christ, in His sovereignty, bestows those gifts. Romans 12:6 tells us, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. That's sound theology right there. And of course it is, because it comes from the Bible. Use your gift that God has given you. And you don't get to wiggle out of it by saying, I didn't get one. Yeah, you did. You might not know it, But if you're in Christ, you have a gift. Now he goes on in verse 8, and he says, therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives and gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he also descended into the lower regions of earth? And he who descended is the one who ascended far above all the heavens that he might fill all things. This is a passage with no small amount of controversy. Very briefly, verse 8, he's referencing Psalm 68:18. In Psalm 68:18, the psalmist is referring to the vision of God triumphing and coming to Mount Zion in triumph, leading a host of captives. And I have to say it because it's there, because if you go look at Psalm 68, I should say, verse 18, if you go look at the verse, it doesn't say he gave gifts, it says he took gifts. And it's like, what in the world is going on there? Well, there are a variety of opinions. It's hard to know for sure. Basically, Paul, in his exegesis of the passage and moved by the Spirit, in writing this to illustrate that God moves, he has taken those who were captive himself. That means us who are captive by the power of Satan, held in bondage and sin. Now he has liberated us and taken us as a host of captives. And as he ascended on high, he distributed gifts. Acts 2:33 references this. Numbers 18:6, you don't need to go there, but it's a very interesting passage that could have been in Paul's mind. In Numbers 18:6, God says, I took your sons and gave them to you as priests. He's talking to the tribe of Levi. So there's the taking and the giving that is God's prerogative. He took us as captives, and he gives us gifts that we would glorify him in how we live out our lives by using these gifts. So then he goes on to say again, by ascended, what does it mean but that he descended? I like, quite frankly, what the ESV says. He also descended into the lower regions, the earth. Some of your versions might say to the lower depths of earth. Some might reference Hades. It's hard to say. It's hard to say for sure. But I think just in terms of the configuration of the cosmos, heaven is above, earth is below. And so Jesus descended. Philippians 2 tells us how he humbled himself, emptied himself, made himself in the form of a bondservant. He came to earth, and then he went to the cross. He was tortured. He was crucified. He died. He was dead. He was in the grave. And then he rose. And then after that, he ascended. He ascended. And in his ascension and going on high, now he sends the Holy Spirit. And through the Holy Spirit, we have those gifts. Christ has triumphed. That's what Paul is saying here. Christ has triumphed. He has set us free to serve him. We ought to be singing hallelujahs because of what he has done, transforming our lives and enabling us now to live to serve him. He is in the highest of heavens. He fills all things. And what he's also saying here is basically between heaven and earth and the netherworld, the spiritual realm, the heavenlies, as Paul refers to it throughout this letter, there isn't one area of the cosmos where Christ doesn't reign. Or, to put it positively, Christ reigns everywhere. And we need to live our lives in service to him. because he's given gifts to men in his triumph. And what are these gifts? In verse 11, he says, and he gave the apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, and teachers. And right away, some of you are going, well, there you go. I'm not in that list. I don't have a gift. Not so fast. He gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, and teachers. Why? Verse 12, to equip the saints for the work of ministry. So, here I am this morning, just one minister talking to a room full of ministers. He made us saints so that we would do the work of ministry. Being a Christian is not a spectator sport. It's not. It'd be easy to say we all got to get in the game, but there's much more at stake than a mere game. We're in a war. And before we get to the end of this book, we'll find out more about that spiritual battle. None of us is immune from it. So he gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, shepherds, teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ until we all attain to the unity of the faith of the knowledge of the Son of God. Now, you need to know that this is one long sentence in the Greek from verse 11 through verse 16. And in a lot of your versions, it remains one long sentence until you get to verse 15. But I just want to break it up a little bit. This is how we live. We do the work of ministry. We are involved in building up the body of Christ. Have we attained to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God? Are we as united as we can be? Have we grown in knowing and experiencing Christ to the nth degree? No, there's still room for growth for all of us. There's still room for growth for Grace Bible Fellowship. And we need each other to be part of it. Have we attained maturity? You know, to mature manhood. In other words, Paul is obviously, again, using the image of a human body, a human individual, a human adult. Grow up. We are to grow up. We're to be mature in our faith. We need to think biblically. And then in verse 14, he takes the negative, so that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness, and deceitful schemes. The devil is a con artist. He deceived Eve. That hasn't stopped since. If we're not careful, we can all be deceived. That's why we need to grow in maturity. It's a good start to be able to sing, Jesus loves me, this I know. That's good theology. But we're not to stay there. We're to build upon that truth. Grow in the knowledge of the Son of God. Grow into maturity. Now, you know, we live in a time where you listen to the news and you think, oh no, it's this. Oh no, it's that. Oh no, it's something else. If we grow in maturity, we don't have to be rattled by what happens in the news. Do you know that 160 years ago or so, this country was torn apart by a civil war? Estimated at least 600,000, if not 1 million, Americans were killed in that. And you don't think that there were people thinking, We're living in the last days. Guy by the name of Martin Luther in the 1500s. God used so powerfully. Despaired that the church was in the last days because of the might of the Ottoman Empire. If you read any church history at all, you'll find in pretty short order, just about every generation has despaired that they were in the last days. But if we're in the last days, we should not despair. We should be stirred to greater godliness. Christ is returning. That should be our hope. He's coming back. That's why we need to grow in maturity. That's why we need to think biblically. Don't be children. Now, we used to tell Kevin, you don't have to grow a full year this year. Yes, I do. I'm 4 and a half and I'm going to be 5. And you could say, you can slow down. No. Because when you're little, what do you want? You just want to be big. But I think the danger is too much of us in a spiritual realm. We just want to be little. And Paul, writing on the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, doesn't give us that option. So we need to grow up. And then he says, instead of being torn by the deceitful schemes, rather we're to speak the truth in love. We are to grow up, there it is, grow up in every way unto him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, there it is, we need each other, we need everything from everybody to make the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. Church is unity and diversity moving toward maturity under the Trinity. That's who we are. So let's encourage one another to walk in a manner worthy of our calling, and you have my permission to tell one another, grow up. Let's pray. Father, this is a weighty thing. You've called us to yourself. You've called us to yourself for your glory. Yes, we rejoice that we are saved. We rejoice that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And we must recognize that you've called us to a purpose to do the work of ministry. Lord Jesus, you have triumphed. And by your power, by the gifts you give, by the Holy Spirit, we can and we must do the work of ministry, growing to maturity, growing into you, because you fill all things. And to be a part of the church that lives and glorifies you, so that when we gather, we don't see each other necessarily. We see Christ, because you are on display here. And so move among us, stir us to growth, to love and good deeds for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.